Time to clear the air about a technological innovation some say could have a profound impact in the battle against climate change. David Pogue has a crash course.
By this point, we know that all this is a result of all this. We are cutting back on our emissions, but the science says not fast enough.
We're currently emitting about 6 million tons per hour, and it's like pulling a warm blanket over us. It's causing climate change.
Lori Gaitry runs commercial strategy for a company called 1.5, a company with a radical idea.
In essence, what we're building is a big vacuum cleaner for the CO2 molecules in the air.
It's a technology called direct air capture, and it sounds like magic.
You push a button and the plant starts to work.
But actually, it's just chemistry. Huge fans blow outside air across a liquid that absorbs the carbon dioxide molecules. The clean air then returns to the outside. They convert the trapped carbon dioxide into pellets, and when you heat them up, you get pure carbon dioxide gas flowing into collection tanks.
And then what happens to the carbon dioxide you've sucked out of the air?
So today people are simply burying the CO2 underground. They're also turning the carbon into synthetic fuel so we can put it into an airplane or a truck or a ship, some of those hard to decarbonize sectors. People are putting the carbon dioxide into concrete. People are making diamonds. People are making fizzy drinks.
This demonstration plant in British Columbia, Canada, can pull 4 tons of carbon dioxide a day out of the air. It's been built by Carbon Engineering, a sister company of 1.5. Its next project, opening this summer, will be a much bigger deal.
What we have here is a model of our first commercial plant that's being built in Texas.
So this one's about 300 times bigger than what we see here.
So how many tons a year will this pull out?
So this pulls out 500,000 tons per year.
How many plants like that will it take to avoid disaster?
Climate experts believe that by 2050, we would need to build 10,000 to 20,000 of those 1 megaton building blocks to be a complement to all of the other work that we're doing to solve climate change. So it's a big build out of new, basically just like the water treatment industry, now we're going to have an air treatment industry.
Will they be better looking?
This looks fabulous.
sorry.
This is exciting. This is as beautiful as chemical plants get.
Well, wow. Direct air capture sounds like a perfect solution. We can save the planet with chemistry. Really, there's only one little problem.
Direct air capture is not a real solution. We do not have time to waste with this useless technology.
Mark Jacobson is a professor of environmental engineering at Stanford University. He thinks that direct air capture is a huge boondoggle for one key reason.
You need these big fans and you need the chemical, and it takes a lot of electricity to do this. Even in the best case, when it's renewable electricity is used to run it, it's preventing that renewable electricity from reducing more carbon dioxide by replacing a fossil fuel power plant or a fossil fuel heating source.
In other words, we get about 60% of our electricity from dirty fuels. So why would we use our renewable sources to remove the pollution from gas and coal? Wouldn't it be simpler, easier, and more effective to use that clean energy directly and then just eliminate the whole fossil fuel infrastructure?
You have to think about who's proposing this technology.
Plants capture CO2. What if other kinds of plants captured it too?
Who stands to benefit from carbon capture and direct air capture? It's the fossil fuel companies.
And sure enough, most air capture companies are funded by the oil industry.
Today, Oxy is a carbon management leader.
For example, Occidental Petroleum owns 1.5 and Carbon Engineering.
They're just saying, well, we're extracting as much CO2 as we're emitting, therefore we should be allowed to keep polluting, keep mining.
Do the oil reps hate you?
Oh yeah, well, diesel people hate me, gasoline people hate me, ethanol people hate me, nuclear people hate me, coal people hate me. they do, because I'm telling the truth that we do not need any of these technologies.
How do we know that the oil and gas company's ultimate motivation is to just do a big number on the public saying, you don't have to stop with the emissions anymore because we're going to invent this to suck it down. Keep on driving those cars.
We get that question a lot. I guess that is all of our job and not their job. We need to get ourselves off fossil fuels, and that will dry up the market for those fossil fuel producers, and we need to create the market for them in doing what they call carbon management, which is really taking carbon out of the air and putting it underground or creating carbon products for us.
But big chemical plants aren't the only way to pull carbon out of the air. Experiments are underway with algae.
So I'm guessing it works because algae is a plant, and plants breathe carbon dioxide.
Breathe carbon dioxide.
And give us oxygen in return.
That's right.
And smaller, more efficient plant designs.
One potential way is the concept of like a rotating packed bed in the place of an absorber tower.
John Northington is the director of the National Carbon Capture Center in Alabama. With funding from the Department of Energy, it's nurturing new technologies that can remove carbon from our air and bring down the costs.
So today's costs for direct air capture range anywhere from $500 to $600 a ton. And we're working to drive that cost down to where we're in the neighborhood of less than $200 a ton. And it could go lower.
I mean, in 50 years, people could look back on this as the beginning of the technology that helped save the planet.
Yeah, I mean, and how great would that be?
In the meantime, controversy or not, the carbon removal industry is charging ahead. 130 air capture plants are in the works around the world. Lori Gaytree emphasizes that they won't be a silver bullet, but they will be an important part of the answer.
When we put all the tools together, wind, solar, electric vehicles, and carbon dioxide removal at scale, we have everything. We actually know how to get to net zero. We need to roll up our sleeves and get to work.